Hi, I'm Uri Pekkanen from Platform.sh. I'm Uri Pekkanen absolutely everywhere on GitHub, Twitter, LinkedIn. And this is going to be balancing your latency budget. So the theorem will be that having a model of latency will make you money. And money is good. Not all money, not always, but... We'll define... And this is already like, hey, what? Latency as whatever is non-productive time. And we're talking about APIs, right? So specifically about APIs. The latency of your API is going to be the time it doesn't do things that are really interesting for the end user. Basically, when you have an API call, there's going to be like three moments within the call. They're going to be encapsulated by the user waiting for a response. Somewhere in between, there'll be a system doing something. And potentially behind it, there'll be other stuff that happens that potentially is useful or not. There will be backend systems, but there will also be like the small moments in between one thing talking to another thing. So, like, the system doing something is our facts of life, right? We do a calculation, we render some useful thing, but the others are like, yeah, it depends on other systems. Potentially, I can make them faster and have less latency, I don't know. And the user waiting is like, yeah, we hate that also, like networks and stuff, but we have a physical world, we have physical limitations in which we live. Again, what I'm going to try to say is that the thing in the middle is the value, is a system doing something, and that's not your latency. And the other two parts are problematic. Because basically, fighting against physics is kind of a losing battle. So, like, buildings don't jump off unless you have a parachute. So, like, what's the fighting with physics thing? Speed of light, around 300,000 kilometers per second. Earth, so North Pole to South Pole, around 20,000 kilometers? Ooh. Ah, yeah, the speed of light in fiber, refraction in glass, 1.5. So, like, in a perfect fiber, it's around 200 kilometers per second, around 20,000 kilometers North Pole to South Pole. Fibers don't go actually in straight lines either, so, like, the floor of the ocean stuff. So, like, Paris and San Francisco, we're in Paris, everybody else is in San Francisco, and so that's around 9,000 kilometers. Some other facts of life, this is not really physics, but this is computing, TCP, handshake, so we kind of have to do the round trip. HTTP is evil, right? We're all supposed to be doing HTTPS, security, good. Double handshake, so like three round trips. So, Paris is 130 milliseconds away for time to first byte. So, before the moment we even start thinking about doing anything useful, we're going to have 130 milliseconds, and that's physics. The thing you can't fight against. And, you know, if you, like, you look at usability studies, 130 milliseconds is already something you feel. If you're going to double it and have 260, and imagine a single page application that is going to do multiple calls, this is already, and we haven't delivered any value, right? We haven't done anything. That's non-negotiable. That's like facts of life. I'm going to fight physics. But before I do, I'll show a flame graph because it's so visually appealing. So who's aware of flame graphs? Most everybody. That's nice. So it's a way to show how much time things take. And they're like divided into smaller things. So like this is the whole thing. This is, this is Drupal running. And within it, we're gonna start, you know, running other stuff. There will be a component starts and stops. So someone here, it talks to a MySQL service. It's a really small thing there. And then the function returns. And this is the end of something doing something. And it's really nice frame graphs because they allow you to go like in a rabbit hole and what takes up until the small things. And as a matter of fact, like it's really like a question of stuff within stuff, because the whole thing we saw there, like this, is basically just this within the full system doing something useful. So this thing is the MySQL call. So it's just a really, really small spike here in my PHP thing doing something. And here, it's a smaller thing. This is the kernel sending a single packet, a single TCP packet. So basically, you know, we can go, when we look at latency, we can go as, you know, really small sample size, or look at the global picture. But I'm gonna try to look at the Russian doll in something we're gonna to be able to understand. So we had this ID. User wants to do something useful. Gonna wait for a long time because physics. And so this is our API call. And if we look at our own flame graph, that is a bit less colorful, nice, but easier to understand. Within it, there's going to be the time up until from the user equipment up until to some edge, some network that is close to them. So these days, cloud operators have points of presence everywhere. And there is a very good chance that any correctly constructed system will allow you first to connect to an edge. And where there is a real live HTTP server, and then bounce you to some system boundary, which is going to be, for example, the elastic load balancer, the network load balancer at a cloud boundary, which is going to jump into another HTTP server. So we already had two HTTP servers. Like a third HTTP server, which is probably going to be like the router of your API. And then there's going to be some business code doing something useful. Going to give a response to the first HTTP server. You see, these are really small latencies. They're really, really close by. And then response to another, and then we're going up to the edge and back to the user. And within it, you know, you have like big chunks that are our physics, that are speed of light, distances, and the ones that are like within your cloud provider, then a really small network latency. And within it, you know, we have this big useful thing we are doing. Oh. So we've seen one thing, that in our latency budget, so when latency, again, is the non-useful stuff, so we have physics, and we have a bit of robustness, like the really small latency we added, probably like if on the 130 milliseconds there, we're potentially in microseconds, and it's the time where we add a load balancer, another HTTP server in front of it. Like really small. I'm going to give you some postulates because, again, we're talking about time, about slowness. I would say that writes are more valuable than reads. And, reading is kind of easy because usually you can change the level of staleness you accept. And you can just, you know, caching reads is kind of easy. Writes sometimes, are very, very slow because they change the world and the world is slow. For example, an API can be a food delivery system The fact that you have very quick latency toward the system that interacts with you is nice, but the food should be prepared slowly, because fast food is bad food. So I work for platform.sh, and when I look like at our API and try to like to understand, you know, you have so many different, you know, methods, and there are some that are much more valuable than others. This is probably the most valuable HTTP method we have. Merge in our world means, hey, go to production, take whatever was in the staging cluster and put it into production. On Friday, deploy on Fridays, come to the booth. So that's kind of the system doing something useful, and it's doing something slow, right? Putting a whole, like your whole microservices infrastructure into production can take some time. We try to be fast. It's going to be like 30 seconds, maybe a couple of minutes for something extremely complicated. Maybe a backup can take minutes, because if you have, you know, gigabytes of data, swooping it off to some other place for it to be durable and offsite, going to take time. And I'm going to add one more postulate, and it's going to be important. And this is that some data must stay cohesive. So some data can just float around anywhere and be really close to the user. And there are many reasons for which data needs to be cohesive. One is that there's the invariant of collocating data and processing. Basically, CPUs, in order to do something useful, need to have the data next to them. It's an invariant. We can't do anything about it. If you want to calculate something interesting, you have to have the data near the processor. But also, like, compliance. If you're a bank, you don't forcefully want to have the data, your internal data, float all around many different cloud providers around Earth. You might want, you know, to have that somewhere you know. And also, like, technical things that don't make sense distributed. Git is already distributed, but the repository you're operating on needs to be cohesive, because it's magical Git, and it does Git pack, and it does garbage collection and stuff like that, that don't make sense in a distributed fashion. If it's the authority of your deployment, it needs to be one consistent. So your Git repository, in our case, it's like the object we manage, needs to be somewhere. But hey, 2018, we're a fully distributed team. So your developers, we have people in New Zealand. So how do you beat physics? First, let's, you know, I showed a curl, and there was this small part of the curl where I passed an authorization header. And interestingly enough, verifying a token is something that is non-trivial, because you have to distribute secrets, but it's kind of easy to put at the edge. So just adding that other, you know, like couple of HTTP layers, we can do something really, really easy, which is go verify a JWT token at the edge, and ta-da. Now, the user only has to wait. This is the edge. Verifying a token is a trivial operation. So instead of waiting the whole thing, politesse oblige, we can say no quickly. And this has like another added benefit, right? All of these things, non-authenticated requests, don't even ever go into your infrastructure. So it's not bothered by it. You don't have a rate limiting issue. And the edge, you know, like the different providers you'll find, the vendors will tell, yeah, gateways. There are many ways to do edge these days. You'll see with your own use case. And we've seen, you know, that like already the snow that doesn't have a great value to the user, but at least we give them the value of speed from 130 milliseconds. We passed to something that is probably 4, because an edge is often like 4 milliseconds away. But that, you know, like, yay, I got it really, really fast. But it says no. So, nah. Let's try to get a quick yes. So we showed you the platform merge thing is servers get into life. It's a strong, slow thing. But if you look at the semantics of what I say when I say git merge, basically in my world, it means the world is in state A and it needs to become in state B. Please make the necessary arrangements. I really like, you know, HTTP semantics. So we have 200 okay, but we can also say 202 accepted. And return immediately. Ooh, double slide. So suddenly, I cut the useful stuff from here. So I only did the processing that is necessary to say yes. Something is going now to asynchronously happen in the backend. And stuff, you know, yay, stuff deploys, but how do I know? Now, but we're missing some value, right? We may be successfully deployed, but now the user doesn't know about it. That's sad. 202 in the specs in the RFC says non-committal. But this was a commit! So what happens if before I try to change the world, the slow thing? What happens if I start the reading before I do the writing? We have a nice API method like that, that says subscribe to an object. And I could not succeed in putting the video in the slides. So I'm gonna go off my slides and like, ooh, how do you do that? Yeah. Oh, it's here. But I don't have glasses, so how do you do that? Okay, one second. Desktop. Because I'm not gonna run. Something like that. Yeah. So here on the left side, I call subscribe, and on the right side, I just made my post, and you saw that was like I'm gonna do it again. How incredibly quick this is, the response. And so that's the interesting thing. Like, because how are we beating physics here a bit? At least we're not paying. This is a TLS connection, but it's already open. So basically, I'm only waiting for one side of the three. I'm just waiting for packets coming in. This is just an open already stream. So I'm basically paying a third of the 130 milliseconds. I'm doing the same thing. The user gets notified the second in which the merge succeeded. And we bit physics together. That's nice. So basically, what we did, we took like the full story of a single action by the developer, and we were extremely user-centric. We tried to understand what were the moments in which we gave value and try to decouple the things such that if we have to say no, we can see it really, really quickly. And if we have to say yes, and if we can say yes, we can do it on two channels. When I said that a model of latency is going to make you money, it simply means that a model of latency is part of a user-centric API design. If you think about the value you are delivering in the different moments, in the different methods, and even within a single method, if you kind of try to break it up into the moments in which someone is supposed to be waiting and the moments in which you can return early, You can get extremely fast responses, even over stuff where it's the world and a slow, slow world. So, when you look at your API design, it is incredibly interesting these days to look at what can you project to the edge. Some of the stuff is going to be just stale reads, and stale reads are incredibly cool to just, you can just use Fastly or like, you know, a CDN, pass all your traffic through it, you're going to get 4 milliseconds of time to first byte and potentially some good cacheable content. Event stream for responses is a really interesting model. And usually it means that you can have a single subscriber, so the client can have a single subscriber and get the responses for all of the mutating effects around it, which is kind of cool. Because slow is valuable, because basically you don't want to have clients blocking on slow mutating things, but you do want to be able to inform a client when something succeeded. And by the way, just if anyone was in the previous talk, in platform.sh with a single API call, you can back up a full microservices cluster consistently, so it's not forcefully difficult. Thank you so very much. Oh, that was the version of my slides that were before. Because I do. And if there are any, am I over time or not? I'm over time. Thank you so very much.
Sorry, thank you.